outline of this book is on chapter 1, verse 19, and so I read it to you again. It says there, Jesus said, write the things which you have seen, that is chapter 1, and the things which are, that is chapter 2 and 3, and the things which will take place after this, that will be chapter 4 through 22. But last week, I'm here. I was just so consumed by the Spirit in worship that I don't even know where to start. But praise the Lord, that's a good thing. But in chapter 5, we have learned that Jesus is worthy to take the scroll, amen, because he paid the price. And I don't want to go back there, but he is worthy. And that's why Jesus is worthy of our praise, amen. And now, so in chapter 5, the scroll was given to the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world, the worthy one. And then remember, I told you the scroll was the title deed of the earth. And the title deed of the earth, it contains also the judgment of the earth. And that's what we are going to talk about this morning. But, you know, here's the bottom line for us. Here's the good news that I want you to take home with you this morning. That whatever happened in chapter 6, okay, we are not going to be here. That's it? That's all you can say to that? Amen. All right. Whatever happened, whatever we are going to learn in Revelation chapter 6, I want you to take this with you. We are not going to be here. Amen. Praise the Lord. Because your first answer will be amen. If I would be, really? You know. But are you guys ready? All right. Are we all in Revelation chapter 6? Look at verse 1 and 2. Now I saw, when the Lamb opened one of the seals, and I heard one of the four living creatures saying, with a voice like thunder, come and see. And I looked, and behold, a white horse. He who sat on it had a bow, and a crown was given to him, and he went out conquering and to conquer. Now, who was the rider of this white horse? If you say Jesus, you're wrong. This was the Antichrist. Okay, this is the Antichrist. The rider of this white horse is the Antichrist, the false Christ. Now, the false Christ, beginning his conquest on earth, but notice, he had a bow but no arrows, which indicates that he conquers the nations peacefully. Did you know that our world is already set up for the Antichrist? Look at this economy that we have. You know, one thing I ask right now, where are all the money in the world is going to? If the world, the whole world is hurting right now, economically, right? And so, did you know, a lot of Bible scholars believe that the world is ready for one world government, maybe one ruler. Ooh, guess what? I believe the Antichrist is being, his way is being paved for him to sit on the throne, and it's coming very soon. In my opinion, maybe the Antichrist is already here on earth. But, you know, he cannot do anything. You know why? Ask me why, Pastor. Because there's someone who's restraining him. And that is the Holy Spirit in the church that works through the church. We're still here, that's why. Did you know that? But when we were taken out, according to the Bible, guess what? The Antichrist will take over. Did you understand that, folks? Okay, let me... Again, here's the good news. for us Christians. The Antichrist is being held back from his power to take over the world by the Holy Spirit working through and within the church. I want you to turn your Bibles to 2 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 1 through 7. 2 Thessalonians. Oh, sorry. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 1 through 7. I'm so sorry, okay? Now let me read this to you, okay? Now, brethren, concerning the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and our gathering together to him, we ask you not to be soon shaken in mind or troubled, either by spirit or by word or by letter, as if from us, as though the day of Christ had come. Now, verse 3, let no one deceive you by any means, for the day will not come unless the falling away comes first and the man of sin is revealed, the son of perdition, who opposes and exalts himself above that is called God or that is worship, so that he sits as God in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. Do you not remember that when I was still with you, I told you these things? And now you know what is restraining. You see the word restraining there? Means withhold or suppress, that he may be revealed in his own time. For the mystery of lawlessness is already at work. Only he who now restrains will do so until he is taken out of the way. Until the church, until the Holy Spirit in the church were taken out of the way, guess what? The Antichrist cannot do anything here on earth. Amen? Hallelujah. What is that to us? What is that to us? The Lord makes sure that we are taken care of. The Lord makes sure that we, his children, were safe in his arms before he poured out his wrath here on earth. Do you understand that, folks? Obviously, I believe in the pre-trib. You heard that, you know? I believe the great tribulation will not happen until the Lord take out his church from the earth. That is what we believe. That is rapture. Rapturo. In Latin, where we get the English word rapture, or in your Bible is the words caught up, or in Greek it would be harpazo, kind of like that. Amen? So, in this, that's why chapter 6 of Revelation, we're not going to be here when these things happen, because God is pouring out his judgment upon earth right now. Do you understand that, Bible students? And so, the Antichrist is being revealed on verse 1 and verse 2. But I want you to know, once again, he had a bow but no arrows, which indicates that he conquers the nations peacefully. However, it is soon followed by destruction. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 1 and 4. 1 through 4 tells us that, you know. Yes, he will make a peace treaty on the world, but after that, the peace will be just vanished, and it will become a chaotic world, folks. Believe me on this one, because the scripture tells us that. Okay, do you understand? Now, that is the first seal with a white horse and a rider, right? Now, let's look at the second seal. It's on verse 3 and verse 4, if you want to outline your Bible, folks. Now, look at this. When he opened the second seal, I heard the second living creature saying, come and see. By the way, I forgot to explain to you, the living creature here, do you remember there's four living creatures around the throne? And I believe these were powerful angels. High-ranking angels. There could be cherubim or seraphim, kind of angel that guards the throne of God. with the 24 elders that has a lesser thrones around the throne of God. Do you understand that, folks? So, look at this. In verse 4, another horse, fiery red, went out. And it was granted to the one who sat on it to take peace from the earth, and that people should kill one another. And there was given to him a great sword. Oh my, that is scary. People will kill one another. Now, how many of you here watch the news lately? It's a lot of wars, right? People are killing one another already, amen? Right? But the Great Tribulation, it will be worse. It will be worse, folks. This red horse symbolizes great blood shed upon the earth. The peace that the Antichrist brought is false peace, because the Lord can bring the genuine peace on earth. Amen? You know, we can pray for peace right now, which is, it's still good. Pray for peace on earth, but let me tell you this. I don't think there will be peace on earth, folks. I'm so sorry, okay? If that would be a bad news to you. But that's just the reality. United Nations, they tried to have a peace treaty with Israel and the Palestinian and all that, but the peace will last maybe 2 months. Sometimes it's only days. They start killing again, you know? Killing one another. So, the Antichrist will bring peace here on earth, but it's a false peace. Because the second horse, the fiery red horse, will bring war here on earth. Amen? Do you understand that, folks? So this fiery red horse indicates clearly the methods of international agreement and diplomacy will not bring lasting peace. Now let's talk about the third seal. The third seal with a black horse. You know, you can take note, third seal, black horse. You can put famine. And you can outline your Bible like that. See? The third seal. When he opened the third seal, I heard the third living creature say, "Come and see." So I looked, and behold, a black horse, and he who sat on it had a pair of scales in his hand. And I heard a voice in the midst of the four living creatures saying, "A quart of wheat for a denarius, and 3 quarts of barley for a denarius, and do not harm the oil and the wine." Now, so we see here the third seal is a black horse, and it indicates famine, if you would. Are you with me? Now, famine is the inevitable aftermath of war. Folks, war and famine often go together. Did you know that? Wow. And I'm just like, oh, notice here in these verses 5 and 6, how hard food will be in those days. If we say today, oh man, it's kind of hard, the food. Actually, here in the United States of America, we don't have problem with food, right? Can I hear amen to that? If you don't say amen, look at your... Sorry. Did I say that? Forgive me. Look at us. We're big. That's what I'm trying to say. We're big here. You know, when we moved here to the United States, I only weighed, I kid you not, 125 pounds with 27 waistline. Man, now I have 127 waistline, 2,700 pounds. You know, I'm just like, man, I love the food here in the United States of America. Oh, I love it. But, folks, right now we're not having problems. Yes, yeah, some parts of the world are having problem with famine right now. But man, when God will pour the judgment here upon the earth, it will be terrible. You know how terrible that is? According to the scripture, one part of wheat, okay, it will cost you a day of wage. Let's say how much you make in a day right now. That will cost you one quart, or that will give you one quart of wheat. And one quart of wheat will only feed one person for one day. Oh my. Obviously, that's a terrible, terrible time, right? Right now, you can pay $5.92 for a double-double at In-N-Out with pink lemonade, you know, and french fries. Oh, man. By the way, I love In-N-Out, you know. I'm not trying to promote In-N-Out, but it's good, you know. But can you imagine in those days, you know, in the future, when God will, when our Lord Jesus Christ, if you will start breaking the seal for the judgment here on earth. That is scary, isn't it, folks? Now look at this. Verse 7 and 8 will be the fourth seal. And that would be, and the horse for that fourth seal will be pale horse or pale green horse. Green, pale green. In Greek, you know the word pale, it could be, you know, like light green, kind of like that. Pale green horse, okay? Now, let's go read this. When he opened the fourth seal, I heard the voice of the fourth living creature saying, come and see. So I looked, and behold, a pale horse, and the name of him who sat on it was Death. And Hades followed with him. Now, the word Hades here, it translates grave. Okay, so death and grave followed with death, or I should say, sorry. And the name of him who sat on it was Death, and grave followed death. And power was given to them over a fourth of the earth to kill with sword, with hunger, with death, and by the beasts of the earth. Oh my. Now let's spend a little bit time on the on this fourth seal. Now, so the fourth seal is death and Hades. Are you taking that note on your outline? Okay, let's look at the sequence again. The drive for conquest with the white horse, we see that, that is the white horse, had led to warfare and bloodshed, that is the red horse, okay, which had brought famine, that is the black horse, resulting in death and grave, that is the pale horse, the fourth seal. Did you understand that? If you see all the sequence, you can put it all together right now, right? But look at verse 8 once again. So I looked and behold a pale horse, and the name of him who sat on it was Death, and Hades followed him. And power was given to them over a fourth of the earth. Let me pause there. What is that supposed to mean? Oh man, that means one fourth of the population here on earth will die. That is scary, isn't it, folks? One fourth of the population here on earth will die. You know, I did my research this morning. Exactly, can I tell you this? All right, my research started November 3rd, 2013, and the time is 7:16 a.m. And I stopped my population counter, and I stopped it there. You know where I stopped? The numbers, the count, right now, the population of the world, okay? Are you ready? 7,190,191,200 people. Okay. Wow, you might ask me right now, Pastor, do you have all that time? You know, yeah, I just want to be accurate, folks. And I stop my population time 7:16 a.m. today. And so, where am I going here? If this fourth seal will start today, okay? Are you guys ready? 1,797,547,800 people will die today. According to the Word of God, will die by way of war, hunger, pestilence, with death, and by the beast who will be hungry and attack humans. In those days, in the near, and I believe, very near future, there were famine in the land that even the beasts of the earth were so hungry, they will end up attacking people and start eating them. And that's what happened there. Oh, look at you. But I don't want you to worry, folks. I don't want you to worry. Because we're not going to be here. We're not going to be here. We're not going to be here. But isn't that scary, folks? Isn't that scary? Oh, I will conclude in all of this later, okay? Just hang in there, hang in there. Give me a few more minutes, okay? Now, 1,797,547,800 will die. That is scary. That will happen today. And nothing cataclysmic has occurred in all of history. Nothing like this. You understand that, folks? What a terrible judgments await the Christ rejecting world after the church is taken up. Oh, let me tell you this. You don't want to be here. You don't want to be here. Oh, you don't want to be here, folks. Now, let's look at the fifth seal. The fifth seal, I call it the tribulation martyrs. Okay? When he opened the fifth seal, I saw under the altar the souls of those who had been slain for the word of God and for the testimony which they held. And they cried with a loud voice, saying, "How long, O Lord, holy and true, until you judge and avenge our blood on those who dwell on the earth?" Then a white robe was given to each of them, that is their reward, if you would. And it was said to them that they should rest a little while longer, until both the number of their fellow servants and their brethren who would be killed as they were was completed. Oh my. Now the question would be this: who are these people who were slain for the word of God and the testimony, and their testimony which they held? Now, first of all, this is not the church. This is not the church, because the church was taken up already. But this indicates that there will be a remnant of believers in the tribulation period. And I believe most of them were the Jewish people. Most of them. Oh, of course, there will be Gentile also. Okay? Are you with me, folks? I know some of you is like, what are we talking here? What are we talking here? You know, in the Great Tribulation period, we're not going to be here in church, right? But think of your friends that you're sharing the gospel right now, and they say no to Jesus, no to Jesus, no to Jesus, or what? But perhaps in the Great Tribulation period, there will be a great revival here on earth. We know that there will be two witnesses, and next week we will talk about this more, a little bit in detail, with those 144,000 in Revelation chapter 7. And by the way, there are not Jehovah's Witness. Okay, let me clear that to you. Because Jehovah's Witnesses, they say, they're the only one who gets saved, the 144,000 in Revelation chapter. I'm like, really? And there's like 1.something million of you now. So where's the rest? So I guess they will do paper, rock, scissors. Part of it, I'm in. I'm sorry, dude. You know, kind of. I'm not trying to make fun of them, but we just have to interpret the Word of God properly. Yeah. Amen. And so there will be a believers. Oops. In the Great Tribulation period, do you understand that, folks? Now, let me tell you this. Did you know some cuckoo people says this? Yes, I say cuckoo, because they're saying this. Well, since there will be some believers in Great Tribulation, guess what? I will live my life as I want them to live my life now. Right? Have you heard that reasoning? Well, if the church were taken out, well, guess what? Then I have my opportunity to receive Jesus. Anyway, after the rapture, you think God doesn't know that? God is just. The Bible says, God knows what you're thinking. Now, here's my reason to that. What made you think that right now, when everything is okay, you cannot even live for Christ? And what made you think that you can live for Christ back then when everything is in trouble? You see, God knows, folks. God knows. God knows. And wouldn't it be stupid, I'm sorry if I use that word, but I'm not saying it in a bad way, wouldn't it be foolish if you have a way of escape now? You have a way of escape now, and take that way of escape now and go through all this difficulty, and you're not even sure if you're going to be saved. See, Bible students, don't put your life in a question mark. Don't live in a question mark. Do you understand that, Bible students? Okay? You have a way of escape now, and take that way of escape now. Amen. Don't go through this hardship. You don't have to go through this great tribulation period. Amen? Do you understand that, folks? Now, so they're crying out to God. How long? How long? In other words, how long are you going to avenge us from these people? Oh, and it says here in verse 11, then a white robe was given to each of them, and it was said to them that they should rest a little while longer, until both the number of their fellow servants and their brethren, who would be killed as they were, was completed. In other words, hang in there and wait for the rest. There are some more who will be martyred. Wait for God's timing. You see, folks, I believe if I can, at least for me, I'm not trying to inject this to you. The believers in Great Tribulation, they are going to face a hardship. Hardship. Because in those times, folks, the Antichrist will make war against the believers. And Daniel chapter 7, verse 21 says, the Antichrist will prevail against them. The believers in Great Tribulation, if you would, they will become loser against the Antichrist. Oh, because their faith will be tested. If you think that your faith is being tested right now, in this side of the tribulation, let me tell you this, folks, okay? In this side, okay, in this side, before the tribulation, if you think that your faith is being tested right now, hold on, there's no comparison to what will be, to what will these believers will experience in that side of Great Tribulation. That is scary. And you have your way out now. Why not take it? find that today. Amen. So, look at this. The sixth seal. The anarchy. Right here. I looked. When he opened the sixth seal, and behold, there was a great earthquake, and the sun became black as sackcloth of hair, and the moon became like blood, and the stars of heaven fell to the earth as a fig tree drops its late figs when it is shaken by a mighty wind. My, this is scary, folks. The sixth seal, this judgment was over the whole world. The entire population would be afraid when the earth itself trembled. And notice, it followed by a cosmic disturbances. Did you know, I read a lot of books concerning, especially the sixth seal. And some Bible scholars, they have the interpretation, you know. Let me tell you this, folks. I just want to keep it simple. I just want to take this literal right here. There would be earthquake, okay? Great earthquake, and the sun became black as sackcloth of hair, and the moon became like blood. Now look at the cosmic disturbances. And the stars of heaven fell to the earth as a fig tree drops its late figs when it is shaken by a mighty wind. Now, how many of you have seen that movie, like a big, whatever you call it, like meteor or something that hit the earth, and man, it created a major disaster upon earth. And guess what? Folks, that's just a movie there. But in the future, it's going to happen, folks. It is going to happen. This could refer to terrifying meteor shower with meteors striking the earth right here. Isn't that scary? And you know what's funny? Or it's just what's amazing to me is right now, our scientists and all the astronauts, they are tracking a lot of stars, what we call them stars, or meteors, like heading towards the earth already. And they don't know how we can stop these things. Well, I'm going to tell them this. Well, according to the Bible, it will hit the earth. It will hit the earth. Right? These things will hit the earth, folks. Now, look at verse 14. Then the sky receded as a scroll when it is rolled up, and every mountain and island was moved out of its place. Wow. The earthquake was so great that the mountains and the island will move out of its place. I don't know if you're not scared. You see, I'm scared for them. I'm not scared in a way personally because I know I'm saved. I'm not going to be here. But if you are not a believer, if you don't have Jesus Christ into your heart right now, this is what you are going to experience right here. It's either escape this now or experience this in the future. Oh boy. Wow. There will be such upheaval on earth that every mountain and island will be removed from its place. Probably as a result of the great earthquake. And the author of the Hebrew, in Hebrews chapter 12, verse 26 and 27, let me read that to you, folks. I don't think I gave that to our brother Bobby. In Hebrews chapter 12, verse 26 and 27 says, whose voice then should be heard? But now he has promised, saying, yet once more I shake not only the earth, but also heaven. Now this, yet once more, indicates the removal of those things that are being shaken, as of things that are made, that the things which cannot be shaken may remain. Ooh, my. These are heavy stuff, folks. And I remember when we were still in Philippines, there's a big earthquake back then. I forgot what year was that, 1990 or something? Man, I remember our school was like, there's seven floors in our school, and I'm on the fourth floor. Oh boy, I've seen the parking lot of our school. It's just like, it went like this at first, and then it goes like this, and then went like this, and go. I'm like, oh boy, you know? And I'm looking at the building. Oh, at that time, I don't know how to pray, folks. I have to tell you this, I've learned how to pray. I call Peter, Paul, saints, because that's what I've been taught. And I think I even call the saints that I don't even know they're saints, you know? You know? I'm like, St. Andrew, help us, you know, St. Joseph, you know, St. Skin, or I don't even know if there's a skin or something. All I know is just I'm so afraid, you know, because if I see our building collapsing, guess what, I'm jumping, you know. I don't want to be squeezed by a building, folks. At least I splashed down there. Oh, that's terrible. But you see, folks, but that earthquake will not comparison to this earthquake. You know why? Because it doesn't matter where you are. When this earthquake comes, oh my, it will move mountains. It will move islands from its place. Isn't that scary? I was watching something on Facebook. I was even embarrassed saying this. Something happened in Italy not too long ago. That the earth shifts. People were screaming and screaming. The earth, the mountain, folks, it's just like water flowing. And the people, they don't know what's happening. They don't know what's happening. That's just the taste of it. That's scary. What is the good news then? You're not going to. We are. Okay, I include myself then. We are not going to be here, Christians. That is the good news, right? Some people will say, that's not going to happen. That's not true. That is just the Bible or what? Oh, come on now. Really? Really? If 90% of the prophecy here in the Bible already come to pass, chances are the 10% it will come to pass for us. Amen? Now, check this out. Verse 15, and the kings of the earth, the great men, the rich men, the commanders, the mighty men, every slave and every free man hid themselves in the caves and in the rocks of the mountains and said to the mountains and rocks, notice, the unbelievers, they start talking to the mountains and rocks right now. That's how scary this is. You know what their request to the rocks and the mountains? Fall on us and hide us from the face of him who sits on the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb. For the great day of his wrath has come, and who is able to stand? And let me tell you this. Can I answer that question in the last verse? No one who is able to stand when the wrath of the Lamb will be poured upon this earth. That the mighty men, not those who are in authority or position. I think at that point, everybody, I think the emphasis here that all men will become equal at that point when everything, when the world is in chaos, right? If you're in authority, hey, come on now, feed me. People feed you. Just feed ourselves first, you know? Doesn't matter anymore. The rich, your money cannot save you. Your possession cannot save you. That day comes. You like to work hard for the money. Work hard for the money. Guess what? Your money will not save you. Money will not save you, folks. The unbelievers from all walks of life in those days will be so terrified of the of the one who sits on the throne, that they would prefer that an avalanche fall on them rather than have to face God. Do you see that? Their fear was so great, they would rather be killed by a falling mountain than to face the wrath of the Lamb. Be too late for them. Now, all of these things will happen to this Christ-rejecting world. But again, brothers and sisters, friends, loved ones, my beloved, you have a way of escape. It is your choice. It is your choice. But I want to say this to you. I beg you. Make that choice right now. Choose Jesus now. Because it might be too late for you to. Did you learn something?
Amen.
Will you all please stand? Let's pray.